welcome song. Listen.
Hallelujah.
Come on, let's give the Lord a hand. Praise God. Bless you. And thank you for tuning in with us. We thank God for praise and worship and for giving us yet another day to give him all glory, honor, and praise. I am so thankful that you have joined us for the word of God. And let's go to the word in Romans 8, verse 18. It merely reads these words, "For I reckon that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory that shall be revealed in us." I want to talk for a few moments from this subject. A greater glory is coming out of this. That's right. Let's give the Lord a hand praise for that. That a greater glory is coming out of this. One of the realities that we must learn to accept and to even understand so that we can address, that is the reality that we are ministering to a generation that is dealing with a significant amount of pain. When you look and you talk to various people and when you go different places, you see the results of people who are living in pain. That's what Shakespeare was trying to hint at when he said, "To be or not to be is the question. Whether it is nobler in the mind to suffer the slings and arrows of life's outrageous fortunes, or to take arms against the sea of trouble and by opposing in them." Somehow there was the belief and the thought that we could stop slings and arrows from coming into our lives. But the reality of the matter is all of us have to deal with some level of pain. It was John Lennon who once declared that one of the things that you can always recognize, and that is when a person is living with pain on the inside. Yes, that's pain too. We're ministering to a culture today. The reason that ministries must rise up and pastors and leaders must rise up and tailor their messages to people who are trying to manage pain. I want you to know that we are a nation right now that's dealing with pain. All over the country, we're dealing with pain. We're in pain because we say that we are the United States of America. But it's becoming more and more apparent that we are the divided states of America. We are in pain. We are in pain because this nation is now trying to grapple with whether or not God is pro-choice or pro-life. And when you look at it with a critical eye, what you will find is that God is really both. God is pro-life and pro-choice. Because it was the word who said in John 10:10, Jesus said that I come that you might have life and have it more abundantly. And then now he's always talking about life. And even when we die, we move to a new life. So God is pro-life, but God is also pro-choice. Amen. Because we are free moral agents, which means that we are not robots. We have the right to make decisions concerning our lives and the moves that we make. God never confers salvation on us. He never confers his love on us. He never confers his peace or joy. It is a choice that we make to accept him as our Savior. And I'm so glad this morning that I have life because I have made Jesus my choice. Are you hearing me? We are in pain. We're in pain when we look and there are children that's been snatched out of the arms of their parents for political purposes. And just the other day, we found 50 bodies, or there was 50 bodies found in the back of a truck that's been smuggled and trafficked. Lives have been trafficked. We are in pain as a nation. Children are being shot down in schools and in the streets. Our streets have turned into war zones and shootings almost every day, if not every other day. We are in pain. We're in pain when you look around and you see all of these things that are happening. And then to know that we must learn how to manage this pain. Sanjay Gupta, expert in the medical field, said this one thing about managing pain. He said that there are 2.4 million people that are addicted to pain medications for the first time every year. 2.4 million people get on pain medications every year. That's about 6,000 people a day that tries to manage their pain with medication. And yes, there are times in which you have to take medications to cope. There are times when you can meditate and to not focus on those things that are stressful in your life to help you manage that. But there is nothing like the Word of God that can give us strength for the pain that we're in right now. Listen at what Paul says in Romans, the 8th chapter, verse 18. He says, "For I reckon that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared to the glory that shall be revealed." That's what I'm going to talk about in just a few minutes. I'm going to be back after we take this break right here. I'm going to be back and I'm going to tell you exactly what that means. God bless you.
Surties are here. Neckties and bow ties that will have you dressing with royalty. Surties are bold, unique, exquisite, and affordable. Men don't match their ensemble, they coordinate. Let Surties help you plan your next ensemble with class and style. Find them at pop-up locations online or contact them at SirWalterMack.com for your next tie look. That's Surties, where they will help you dress with royalty.
So then now, let's get deeper into this. What was Paul saying when he says, "For I reckon that the sufferings of this present time shall not compare to the glory that shall be revealed"? You need to understand that when Paul talks about reckoning, and that is a word that the old saints used to use, "I reckon." And so when Paul talks about "I reckon," that is an accounting term of counting something up. I had a dear friend that recently preached at a major conference, and he did such a marvelous job with this particular word. But "for I reckon," it merely means that Paul is calculating something. He's adding something up. And perhaps he's looking at his tribulations, and he has decided that they don't compare to the glory that shall be revealed. So then now when Paul says, "for I reckon," he has a leisure. What he has come up with is that my expenses don't compare to my income. Are y'all hearing me? that perhaps he's saying that my deficits look bad, but then when I look over at my assets, I have to give God glory. Maybe he's saying that my losses don't compare to my gains. Can I tell you that after all you have been through in life, aren't you glad that your good outweighs your bad? Aren't you glad that you've had more healthy days than you've had sick days? Aren't you glad that you have more times when people have blessed you than they have cursed you? I don't know about you, but I praise God right there that when I reckon, when I sit down and calculate all that God has done for me, I want you to know my good days outweigh my bad days. And so then he says, "for I reckon that we cannot compare, that what I'm experiencing, the sufferings that I'm experiencing, cannot compare to the glory that shall be revealed." Can I tell you that good decisions often come from good comparisons? I'll say that again. Good decisions often come from good comparisons. And when you compare the right thing, you will realize that God is blessing you even right now. I remember when I was growing up, and my first car was a Ford Escort. It was a Ford Escort. It was a little white Ford Escort. And back in the day, we didn't have the spinners that they have now. We would go get hubcaps from Western Auto. Somebody remembers that. And I want you to know that I had the little fur around my rear view mirror, and I had me a tinted license plate. Man, that car was fixed up. Oh, my gracious, it was fixed up. I had a nice sound system on the inside. But watch this. I had everything but air condition. And but I want you to know, air conditioning costs a little bit more. And my mother, at the time my father passed, my mother was trying to scrape her pennies together to just get me a car. And so I had everything but an air conditioning. But guess what? I didn't really need an air conditioning. I needed transportation. And so on a hot day, I would have to roll down my window. and put my hand outside the car and hope that the air would hit my hand and come onto my face and cool me off. If I went on a date, and I want you to know that I had to roll down my window, and I look at her and I say, you need to roll down your window too. But here's the deal. Here's the deal. That today, I have a vehicle that has air conditioning. And when I compare the two, I want you to know that driving in a hot car on a 98-degree day cannot compare to getting in a cool car and it's 98 degrees outside. I thank God for air conditioning. What I'm trying to tell you is that when you make the right comparison, you start thanking God for the small things, the little things. You start thanking God for stuff that you really don't even think about, but you thank him. And when you look at this, you must realize that some things in your life does not compare to the glory that shall be revealed. You can't tell me that being in a prison can compare to you having freedom. We're talking about freedom today. I want you to know that you can't tell me that being in prison is better than being free and being free to make a decision about where you live, where you sleep, what time you get up, what time you go to bed. Freedom is much better than that. I want y'all to understand that you can't tell me that having somebody in your life that loves you, that protects you, and that provides for you is better than somebody in your life that mistreats you. You got to make the right comparison. And when God blesses you with people in your life that can love you, that can support you, that can be there for you, you better thank God for that. You better thank God when God put the right people in your life. It's not always a boyfriend, a girlfriend, a husband, a wife, but sometimes you ought to just thank God for good friends who are there. I want you to know you can't tell me that having somebody in your life that's there for you, you can't tell me that being able to go to a job is much better than having no job at all. You can't tell me. So when you compare what God is doing in your life and the way it could have been, you got to give him glory. Paul says that, for I reckon that the sufferings of this present time cannot compare to the glory that shall be revealed. The glory here, the glory here is several kinds of glory in the Bible. And there is a kabod glory, and that is a glory where the weight of God, or God uses his weight to make you important. Are you hearing me? It's an importance. It is a significance that God is performing. So then now that the glory of God can be kabod, it is when God is making you important. Can I tell you that sometimes we have to go through some things to get to some things? And so many of us, we want to have the glory of God revealed in us, but we don't want to have to suffer anything. But can I tell you that if you're going to fight in a war, you got to go to boot camp. Are you hearing me? If you're going to play in the NBA, you got to learn how to practice on the court before you get to the Final Four or before you get to the final game in the NBA. You got to practice on the court. You got to put those hours in. We want glory, but we don't want to develop our story. I'll say that again. We want glory, but we don't want to develop our story. Can I tell you that when you are being developed, sometimes blessings start off as small beginnings. And you learn to thank God for small beginnings, because God has a way of being a big God in small places. I'll say that again. God has a way of being a big God in small places. Don't ever forget, Superman changed his clothes in a phone booth. Yes, he did. It was nothing significant about the phone booth. It was just a little small place, but that's where he transformed into Superman. And what I'm trying to tell you is that you may be in a situation right now that you don't necessarily desire to be in. You may not have the home you want. You may not have the job you want, or even driving the car you want. But if you learn how to give God glory in it, God has a way of becoming big in small places. There is a glory called Kabod. Then there's a glory called Shekinah. Shekinah. Say that with me, Shekinah. That is the glory that sits on us, that lingers, that reveals God's presence, or reveal God's presence in a whole nother way. It's almost like that over there in the Old Testament, that when the priest went into the temple, the Bible says that the glory was so powerful that they could not even stand to minister. They couldn't even stand to minister. And there is a glory in your life that will knock you off your feet. Help me, Holy Spirit. There is a glory that God gives into your life that takes you places that you didn't even imagine you could go, and you do things that you could have never imagined that you could do. You could not have told me 3 years ago that if anything happened to my mother, I would be able to stand and preach her eulogy. But I want you to know that when it happened, the glory was revealed. And God gave me strength, and God gave me stamina and power and certainty and comfort and peace that I was able to stand and speak final words over someone that I love so dearly. Are you hearing me? There are times when his glory is being revealed all around you. And that's why you must continue to pray and seek God's face in everything that you do. You must continue to worship and give him praise. For those of you that can't make it to a church house, then you transform your house and let the glory fill your house. But there's nothing like corporate experience of glory when we all come together and worship God in spirit and in truth. I want you to know that God's glory is real. And whatever pain you're experiencing right now, whatever struggle, whatever strife you are having right now, it cannot compare to the glory that shall be revealed. What God is doing in the midst of it is much better than what you've seen in your past. God bless you. And listen, thank you for joining me on today. And I pray that you will live this week with God's glory filling you in every capacity of your life. God bless you. And I love you with Jesus' joy. Bless you.
You're the God of miracles.
you so much for your generous support so that we can continue to operate in excellence. The following are ways to give tithes and offerings using technology. Use the PushPay app or go to giving page on the Union Baptist website. Use the Cash App, $UBC1200Trade. Use the GiveLify app, Union Baptist Church, Winston-Salem. For Rise Up Giving, please use the designated Cash App, $UnionBaptistRiseUp. If you don't use technology for giving, you may bring your tithes, offerings, and Rise Up campaign payments on Sundays from 10 a.m. till noon. Envelopes will be available. Mail checks only, no cash, just checks to 1200 North Trade Street, Winston-Salem, North Carolina, 27101. All of the sermons and Bible studies are available on demand on our website, UnionBaptistWSNC.org. StarMed provides COVID vaccinations and testing at our church, Union Baptist, Monday through Saturday from 11 a.m. till 5 p.m.